We will now turn our attention to the for statement as a way to construct iteration. Recall that the for statement is a sequence iterator, meaning that it will execute a group of statements once for each item in a sequence object. The syntax or the structure of a for statement is, first of all, the word for. This is followed by a variable, and that variable is typically called the loop variable. Now, we can use any variable we like in that we can make up any name that we wish, although typically we would use a name that might make sense for the iteration process that we're building. In this particular case, let's just make an assumption that we are going to create a for statement that will print a phrase, let's say 10 times. And so we're going to use this iteration simply to count that we're going to do something a certain number of times. So in that case, it might make sense to name the loop variable counter. So let's go ahead and call it counter. So for counter, and that's followed by the word in, and then that's followed by a sequence object. Now, we've already talked about one way to create sequence objects, and that is to use the range function. And so what we'll do is we'll use the range function to create a sequence that contains 10 items. Now, we know that there are a lot of different ways to use the range function, but if we don't care about the values in the sequence object, we simply want to make sure that there are 10 of them, then the easiest thing to do is just to use the default, starting at 0, up to but not including 10, so 0 through 9, so we can just use range 10. And then that's followed finally by a colon. So the entire construct at this point is the word for, a variable usually named in such a way that it makes sense related to the iteration. In our case, we're counting something. The word in, and then a sequence object. In our case, we're going to use the range function to create a range object that has 10 integers, the integers 0 through 9. Now, once we put the colon and hit return, what you'll notice is that nothing happens because we're not finished with the statement yet. Remember that the iterator, the for statement, is going to repeat a process some number of times. So we have to now put that process in place. The statements that are going to be repeated are going to follow this colon. And those statements are sometimes called a block. And what's interesting about Python is that when you create these blocks of statements, they are all going to have a consistent indentation. And so you'll notice that the cursor has indented over because we are now creating the statements, the sequence that is going to be iterated by the for statement. So again, our example is that we want to do something 10 times. Let's say that we simply want to print a phrase, and let's print the phrase Python rocks. So when we do that and hit return, the cursor goes down and says, okay, are there anything other statements that you wish to put inside this iteration? And so we at this point could put another print statement. We could say print I like Python. Now we've got a block that contains two statements, and notice that we could put more. This consistent indentation pattern makes it very easy to recognize which statements are part of the iterated sequence that the for statement is in control of. In this case, let's say that this was all we wanted. We want to repeat the process 10 times, where the process is to print the phrase Python rocks and then to print the phrase I like Python. So if we simply hit return again to say we're done with the entire for construct, notice what happens. The output, when the Python system evaluates this for statement, is to perform those two print statements 10 times. And so the first time through, we see Python rocks, I like Python. The next time through, Python rocks, I like Python. and then again the third time, fourth time, all the way through to the 10th time. Now remember that the range object returned a sequence of integers from 0 to 9. So when we look at the first item in that sequence, the 0, that's when we perform the first block of statements. The second occurrence happens for 1, the third occurrence happens for 2, and so on. Let's look at a slightly different example. Let's go ahead and write the same control structure for counter in range 10, but this time, instead of printing a phrase like Python rocks, let's go ahead and print the value of the counter itself. And so now we'll see for sure what's happening with respect to how the for statement is really executing. Notice that the for statement assigns to the variable counter each value in the sequence object. So if the sequence object is 0 through 9, range 10, 0 through 9, every time we move through the for statement, every time we iterate and perform the print, the value of counter changes. So the first time through, counter takes on the value 0. The second time through, counter takes on the value 1. The third time, counter takes on the value 2. Just as we said before, now we can see it explicitly because we're actually using the value of that loop variable. And that loop variable can be used for any kind of computation we want. So for example, we could modify, once again, this iteration, and we could say for counter in range 10, but this time, let's go ahead and do a calculation. Let's say for every value of counter, let's compute the square, or let's multiply the counter by itself. So we'll say square is a reference to the value of counter multiplied by counter. Now remember how this works as an assignment statement. The right-hand side is evaluated. The value of the counter, whatever it happens to be during that iteration, is multiplied by itself, and then square will be a reference to that value. Now we'll go ahead and just print, in this case, the value of the counter, and then we'll also print out the value of square. So now we're going to see two values printed on each line, the original counter and the square of that counter, and that will happen for every value in the sequence object. And so if we let this run, we can see when the loop variable is 0, 0 squared is 0, when it's 1 we get 1, when it's 2 we get 4, 3 gives us 9, and so on. 0 through 9, and of course 9 squared is 81. The for statement then is the most simple way to build an iteration. In this case we called it a definite iteration, and remember that the range function is very, very capable of producing lots of different variations on sequence objects. And so we have a lot of power now to be able to iterate through different kinds of sequences to be able to perform different kinds of tasks.